everybody. This is Deb with Truthification Chronicles. And as a Hoosier, I've got a report on this one. I just have to, because today, well, you know, May 28th, you'll probably see this the next day. The Supreme Court upholds Indiana law requiring burial or cremation after an abortion. Yep. That's so huge. So, yeah, it says the Supreme Court on Tuesday issued an order that will allow Indiana to enforce a law mandating the burial or cremation of fetal remains following an abortion. Ooh. Now, this back in 2016, if you look down here, this is the Indy Star. Indiana abortion law signed by former Governor Mike Pence is ruled unconstitutional because this was in April of 2018, but he actually signed it in March of 2016 when, you know, he was still governor. And so the Seventh Court of Appeals has affirmed a district court ruling striking down this abortion law. Now, there are different parts of this law that we're going to look at, but part of it here, you know, gives a really good setup for what women have to be provided with so they can give informed consent when they are getting ready for an abortion. And I think that makes so much sense. And when I went through these, there has to be at least an 18-hour waiting time, and the woman has to be given, you know, documentation of who the physician is that's going to be doing it, his medical license number, an emergency telephone number that she can contact 24/7 as follow-up, and all that information. She has to know the nature of the proposed procedure or information concerning the abortion-inducing drug. So they need to tell her about that. They need to tell her, look at this one, objective scientific information of the risks of and alternatives to the procedure or the use of an abortion-inducing drug. And then they have to tell her that there is a risk of infection and hemorrhage, the potential danger to a subsequent pregnancy, the potential danger of infertility. I mean, any operation you go into the hospital to have, you're going to be told this stuff, right? So why would you not tell a woman before she has an abortion? I think they're trying to keep women purposely in the dark about this, because as long as the women have no clue what's really happening, they are more likely to give consent to doing this. When you really inform them, most of them will say, yeah, I don't want to take that step. And look at this one, though. This is massive. Human physical life begins when a human ovum is fertilized by a human sperm. Wow. I mean, that's huge. And you know what? That's not under dispute. That's not part of what they disputed. And so anyway, this is just an Indiana law. Now, when this came out in 2016, I was dealing with some really serious health challenges, and I had an old dog that was 16 years old, and she was kind of on her way out. So I don't really remember everything that went on about it. I knew there was some blowback for him signing it, and I knew that the law had some things in it, but I didn't know it had a lot of this stuff. And actually, you know, this stuff is really good, because they have to show the woman a picture of a fetus that is at that stage of development, and they have to show, you know, the dimensions and anything relevant on the potential survival of an unborn fetus. I mean, they have to tell them everything. In other words, they have to actually inform the woman of what's going to happen to her. And I think this is brilliant. Whoever put this together, bravo. Bravo to the people that put this together. You guys did awesome. Because this really is good. And, you know, if they have to talk about the fetal ultrasound, there should be availability to that. They have to inform the woman how she can have that done. And if she wants to hear the heartbeat, she has to be given that opportunity. If she does not want to have the ultrasound done, or she doesn't want to hear the heartbeat, she has to actually sign papers saying she doesn't want that. So I think that's kind of great. And then, of course, if the pregnancy is of a child less than 15, then that may constitute child abuse. And so they need to make sure that that gets reported, which, again, I think is great. This is the part that the Supreme Court decided not to rule on, that Indiana does not allow a fetus to be aborted solely because of the fetus's race, color, national origin, ancestry, sex, or diagnosis or potential diagnosis of the fetus having Down syndrome or any other disability. So I think that part, you know, the Supreme Court didn't rule on it, but wait until you see what Thomas said about it. And I actually may just do a whole other video on that because his response was absolutely engrossing and brilliant. I mean, that's why I was reading so much tonight, because I read the whole thing, because it was so informative, wonderfully so. Anyway, but we'll get to that in a minute. So anyway, then they have to talk about, you know, the medical assistance benefits that may be available for prenatal care, childbirth, and neonatal care. So, you know, from the government. They have to let the woman know that she has resources, because a lot of times the women that go in there, they feel like they're alone, like they're doing this all on their own, that they can't do it because they don't have any resources. Maybe it's financial resources or emotional support resources. Whatever the case is, they feel like they're on their own and they just can't handle the weight of that. Well, this takes care of that because it says, you know what? You may feel alone, but here are some services that are available for you. There are people who want to help, and there are ways to get some financial resources if you need that. We can help. And so you're not by yourself. You don't have to abort just because of those reasons. And, you know, it says you don't have to. There are resources available. And this one I think is kind of interesting. They also have to inform her that the father of the unborn fetus is legally required to assist in the support of the child. Ah, there you go. He has to do that. And again, these women may not know that. That may be something that they, again, feel that they have to do it on their own. But, you know, hey, he's got to do it. It's part of that. And so, yeah, in the case of rape, the information required under this clause may be omitted, of course. See, they're trying to be really good with women, that they're making it so the woman has the resources, you know, presented to her that she has, so she can make a more informed decision. And, you know, I've been all for this, and I can't understand why there haven't been more laws made that say, you know, you got to tell the woman this, 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 and this, because the abortion people are not doing it. They're not giving them the options. They're not saying, hey, here are some things you could do. And they also need to inform her that there are physical risks to the pregnant woman in having an abortion, both during the abortion procedure and afterwards. And they also have to tell her about this safe haven law, which allows her to give up her baby to take it to like a police station or a fire station or, you know, a hospital and just hand over the baby. If you find you can't do it, you don't have to worry about it. You just hand it over, no questions asked. The baby goes into the adoption system and you're done. You're free. So they're giving the women all these options so they don't feel like they have to have an abortion. Because again, that's the pressure from outside. That's what they're being told, that that's the only option you really have. Well, it's not. So they're giving them all these options. I think this is beautiful. And then they go on and, you know, these different things. There are these forms that have to be made up by the State Department and that they have to actually sign these, and that the right, you know, the woman has a right to determine the final disposition of the remains of the aborted fetus, which we'll talk about in just a minute. And, you know, there's information concerning the available options for the disposition of the aborted fetus. So she needs to know what her choices are once that fetus is outside of her body. What does she want done with it? And again, these things are going to make a woman stop and think. It's like, wow, yeah, maybe this is a real human being, which, you know, they said up there. Yay. I'm glad they said that because I think that's huge. I'm really surprised Planned Parenthood didn't question that. But anyway, so they have to certify in writing. If they don't want those things, they have to actually write, you know, sign a paper saying that they do not want them. So that's kind of nice. Again, it forces the abortion clinic to inform the woman. She has to be informed before she has an abortion. Now, granted, there are some women, it does not make a difference. They don't care. They don't want to know. They have their mind set that they just want to get rid of it. It's not going to affect them. But the majority of women who get in that situation, they're in an emotionally charged situation. You know, they're feeling very trapped. They're feeling confused. They're feeling scared. And, you know, they need to have, I'm glad they put 18 hours in there. I wish almost it were more, but at least 18 hours gives them a chance to stop and think and say, you know what, I do have options. I don't have to do this. So anyway, and then it goes on, and of course, these are the other things that they have to have. And, you know, the woman has to sign off. She doesn't want to see the ultrasound or hear the heartbeat. And so they also have to give them, this is requirement, they have to give them a copy of the perinatal hospice brochure. Now, perinatal is when you have a baby and you know the baby's life is going to be brief. You know, there are some birth defects that just mean the child's not going to live, you know, past a few hours even. So I understand that. But, you know, in that case, there is this option. There's this palliative care, this perinatal hospice and palliative care program. That means that even if your child is going to only live for a few hours or a few minutes, or maybe it dies within your womb, whatever the case is, there are people who are going to help you through that. You don't have to have an abortion. You can still see that child through. And I've read stories of women who have done that, you know, and they've taken pictures of the child when it was born. It was just still alive, but very, very weak. And, you know, they at least got to love that baby for a little bit. So this, you know, this is a video. If you want to watch it, it doesn't have a lot of words. You know, it just has words written there and music. And it's a beautiful story, but it'll probably bring tears to your eyes. So just to give you a warning on that. Anyway, the links, as always, are going to be down below so you can look at it yourself. So then we go to the part of the law that the SCOTUS did actually review. And it has to do with this one right here. Again, I will put these down below. You'll be able to see them down there. And so this one says, an abortion clinic or healthcare facility having possession of an aborted fetus shall provide for the final disposition of the aborted fetus. The burial transit permit requirements of this code apply to the final disposition of an aborted fetus, which must be interred or cremated. So buried or cremated. But they want to be fair about it and not put extra pressure on the woman, so a person's not required to designate a name for the aborted fetus on the burial transmit permit, and, you know, the space for a name may remain blank. Any information submitted in this, under this section that may be used to identify the pregnant woman is confidential and must be redacted from any public records. So at least they're, you know, giving in on that. But aborted fetuses may be cremated by simultaneous cremation. That means that more than one of them at a time. So you don't have to do one at a time like they have to do for regular bodies when they do cremation. So the local health officer shall issue a permit for the disposition of the aborted fetus to the person in charge of interment for the interment of the aborted fetus. A certificate of stillbirth is not required to be issued for an aborted fetus with a gestational age of less than 20 weeks of age. So, you know, that they don't have to give a certificate of stillbirth. That's only for after 20 weeks. But anyway, so this is what they're really upset about, that the abortion clinics have to either bury them or cremate them. Now, for those of you who have seen the videos, Project Veritas, right, that have exposed Planned Parenthood selling baby parts, imagine what this does to Planned Parenthood. Do you know why Planned Parenthood is so upset about it? Oh, yeah. They're losing out big time bucks. Now, I did a video that was about the whole selling of baby parts. And so I will, you know, put a link to that down below too. This is going to cut off their supply. And they're making a lot of money off of those parts. So the idea that they have to inter them or cremate them, not going to go over well. I mean, it's an extra expense for them. So this is what the whole thing was about. Now, y'all know that I'm a teacher. So as a teacher, I like to give you tools that you can use to do your own research. And this is one of them, the SCOTUS blog. This is a blog written by Amy Howe. Now, she says she's an independent contractor and reporter. She tends a little bit towards the liberal side, but she does a fairly good job of being unbiased, at least the things that I've read. And so she doesn't try to put too much of her emotions into it and her own opinion. So this is what she wrote about it, that the justices reversed that lower court's ruling in part of the law. Now, remember, there were two parts that I showed you. The first part was about how they couldn't have abortions depending on race or sex or disability. Well, that part they chose not to even deal with. And we're going to talk about that more when we talk about Justice Thomas's ruling on it. Well, his opinion. He put it, because he put his opinion in the ruling. Okay, and so here's another thing that you can go to. This is the Supreme Court site right here. And you can find all kinds of things. In fact, you can actually get audios for some of the arguments, which I think is kind of interesting. I've listened to a few of them. It's sometimes, you know, the questions that they're asking, and, you know, they surprise me with how they end up, you know, how the ruling ends up, just because some of the questions that the justices ask, it's like, well, I could have sworn that they were going to go this way. So, you know, there's a lot of debate that goes on and everything. But if you come here, you can see their recent decisions. There are several of them. And if you click on this, it'll give you the opinion. Well, the opinion on this one, it uses a lot of legal terms. But essentially, we reverse the judgment of the Seventh Circuit with respect to the first question presented, which was the thing about the first relating to the disposition of fetal remains by abortion providers. So they reversed the decision on that, and we deny the petition with respect to the second question presented. And the second question was the one about second barring the knowing provision of sex, race, or disability selective abortions by abortion providers. Okay, and these are all the Indiana code that it really applies to. Now, I only picked out the first couple here. The K is the first one I showed you, which has to do with the sex and race and disability. This one is the one about the cremation. So, you know, there are more. You can go through all of them. And, you know, there's a lot you can do. If you're really into legal things, this would be something that you want to take time and read through. If you're not into legal things, this part right here, they just kind of basically say, this is what we're doing. And they wanted to point out, one thing that they made sure they pointed out was the law did not affect a woman's right under existing law to determine the final disposition of the aborted fetus. You know, so it has nothing to do with putting any undue burden on the woman. And that was really important that they said that. So they've got, you know, the whole thing here if you want to read it. It's really actually, this part is not all that long. But they do have, so they, again, you know, say that they dealt with the first question, but not, they denied the second one. And, you know, Sotomayor wanted to deny both of them. So then it goes down here, and this is Justice Thomas. Wow. Now, you know, he's a black guy, right? Because that's really important to understand before you read this. I'm not going to read this right now, but again, I'm really seriously considering reading it for one whole video because this is spectacular. Now, I know some of you are really good. If I put a link down below, you'll go to it and you'll read it. But you know, a lot of us don't have time. And so sometimes if you can have somebody reading it to you as you're going about and doing other things, and like if you're driving or something like that, it could come in handy. So I don't know. I haven't decided on that yet, but this thing, I started reading it and I couldn't stop until I got to the end. And the whole thing is 26 pages long. His, like this, like I said, it starts on page 5 and goes through to 24, 23 or 24. So it is something. And he supports everything he's saying. And anyway, he goes on, he says, Indiana law prohibits abortion providers from treating the bodies of aborted children as infectious waste and incinerating them alongside used needles, laboratory animal carcasses, and surgical byproducts. Listen to how he puts that, because that's exactly what it does. It gives dignity to these human beings. You know, they're not treated like trash, like infectious waste. Oh, I just think that is so beautifully stated. And so they said, you know, he goes through and he tells why he, you know, why the Seventh Circuit, this is what they said about it. And, you know, he could go on. And then he also talks about Justice Ginsburg's dissent, which is at the very end. And I'll show you that but I've got more on that. Okay. So we'll get to that in a minute. But anyway, he goes through and he tells all about this. But what I really wanted to talk to you about is that he gets into this part and he says, this statute, you know, it was talking about, I write separately to address the other aspect of Indiana law at issue here, the sex selective and disability abortion ban. This statute makes it illegal for an abortion provider to perform an abortion in Indiana when the provider knows that the mother is seeking the abortion solely because of the child's race, sex, diagnosis of Down syndrome, disability, or related characteristics. And he goes through this and he says, the law requires that the mother be advised of this restriction and given information about financial assistance and adoption alternatives, but it imposes liability only on the provider. Okay, so that's what the Indiana law does. We went through that. And he says, each of the immutable characteristics protected by this law can be known relatively early in a pregnancy, and the law prevents them from becoming the sole criterion for deciding whether the child will live or die. Put differently, this law and other laws like it promote a state's compelling interest in preventing abortion from becoming a tool of modern-day eugenics. This is what his entire thing is about, eugenics. And I'll tell you what, if you have never studied the role of eugenics in our country, it was a horrible time in our country's history, and it gave birth to Hitler's fascination with eugenics. Yep, he was following our laws. In 1907, Indiana, yeah, and this is why it's kind of ironic that all this was going on, because Indiana passed the first eugenics law, and they made it so that people who were in certain situations had to be forcibly sterilized. That would be people who were, they call them imbeciles, but they mean, you know, people who weren't mentally sound, people who were criminals, people who had epilepsy, which I'm really glad that that's not the law anymore, because my mom had epilepsy and it'd been up to them, she would have been sterilized. So I'm really glad that they stopped it before then, you know? He gets into this. He talks about Margaret Sanger's role in all of this. You know, that movement developed alongside the American eugenics movement, and significantly Planned Parenthood founder Margaret Sanger recognized the eugenic potential of her cause. She emphasized and embraced the notion that birth control, quote, opens the way to the eugenist. And he even gives like the documentation and everything for it. The name of this was Birth Control and Racial Betterment. Hello? That kind of says it right there. And so it goes on. I mean, her attitude, I'm not going to read it in this one because it, I can't stop. I can't pick out parts of this that are like, oh, you really have to read this. Oh, you really have to read this. Because it's all like that, I think. The more I read of it, the more I was like, oh, man, this is awesome what he's saying, but it's horrible what happened. And by the way, if you ever talk to somebody who is pro-abortion and they mention something from the Guttmacher Institute, be aware that this guy was the president of Planned Parenthood at one time. So don't believe anything they say, because the statistics are extremely skewed. When you try to look up abortion statistics, that's where it sends you almost all the time, because that's where the liberal media wants you to go to get your real information. It's fake news, okay? They got fake statistics there. But yet they are promoting them as the truth about abortion. It's not true. And I'll tell you, you need to read more of this. Technological advances have only heightened the eugenic potential for abortion, as abortion can now be used to eliminate children with unwanted characteristics, such as a particular sex or disability. Given the potential for abortion to become a tool of eugenic manipulation, the court will soon need to confront the constitutionality of laws like Indiana's, because remember, Indiana said there's a ban on that in that law, but of course that's what they're complaining about too. But because further percolation may assist our review of this issue of first impression, I joined the court in declining to take up the issue now. And I think what he meant there was that it hasn't gone through enough appeal courts yet for that to be challenged in a way that they need to rule on it. So it's not quite time for them. But I'll tell you what, at this point, he starts going into what eugenics was and the science of it. And again, you know, imbeciles, when he uses that, he doesn't mean somebody that's just stupid. He means somebody who is mentally deficient. And so, you know, and you go through this and you read it, and it was so against races. You know, it was, it's white supremacy. That's what the eugenics movement was, white supremacy. And, you know, if you're against white supremacy, you ought to be against this eugenics movement. And there's a place, let me go down here to page 12. This was the Supreme Court. It's actually here. The Supreme Court, through its prestige behind the eugenics movement in its 1927 decision upholding the constitutionality of Virginia's forced sterilization law, Buck v. Bell, and the plaintiff, Carrie Buck, who had been found to be a feeble-minded white woman who was the daughter of a feeble-minded mother and the mother of an illegitimate feeble-minded child. In an opinion written by Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes, Jr., and joined by seven other justices, the court offered a full-throated defense of forced sterilization. We have seen more than once that the public welfare may call upon the best citizens for their lives. It would be strange if it could not call upon those who already sap the strength of the state for these lesser sacrifices, often not felt to be such by those concerned, in order to prevent our being swamped with incompetence. It is better for all the world if, instead of waiting to execute degenerate offspring for crime, or to let them starve for the imbecility, society can prevent those who are manifestly unfit from continuing their kind. The principle that sustains compulsory vaccination is broad enough to cover cutting the fallopian tubes. Three generations of imbeciles are enough. Don't you like that? The principle that sustains compulsory vaccination is broad enough to cover cutting the fallopian tubes. Charming, charming. But then it goes on, and I'm telling you, it was really a race-based eugenics. And he goes on and he talks about how Margaret Sanger really did not like black people. And she made some pretty serious statements about getting rid of them. And, you know, we can't deny that. And remember, she's the person who founded, you know, Planned Parenthood. So how can you deny that? How can you hold her up? And look at this, the eugenic value of birth control propaganda. She agreed with eugenicists that the imbalance between the birth rate of the unfit and the fit was the greatest present menace to civilization, particularly in a democracy like that of the United States, where equality of political power has been bestowed upon the lowest elements of our population. Are you hearing maybe the sound of those smelly Walmart people in this? I mean, no wonder these people believe that way about us. Because of this. I mean, this mentality has been in the elites for a very long time in our country. Remember, 1907 was when Indiana enacted the very first eugenics law. And it really went like wildfire after that. 20-some different states took it over. You know, they all enacted these laws, and it was sad. I mean, it was a very sad time. So anyway, you know, in her view, birth control advocates and eugenicists were seeking a single end: to assist the race toward the elimination of the unfit. And it's, you know, in this thing called racial betterment. But Sanger believed that the focus should be upon stopping not only the reproduction of the unfit, but upon stopping all reproduction when there is not economic means of providing proper care for those who are born in health. So for anyone, if you don't have the economic means, you should be sterilized. Yeah, that's what she wanted to have happen. And of course, you know where they started. They started in the black communities. And that's why, I mean, there's some statements in here I read through and it was like, oh, I cannot believe this. You know, she campaigned for birth control. And to be honest, when she started, birth control was her primary focus. But look, she campaigned for birth control in black communities. In 1930, she opened a birth control clinic in Harlem. And a lot of the beginning ones were put in black communities. And then she had this project and an effort to promote birth control in poor southern black communities. And, you know, this is just outrageous. And then she actually got some ministers to work with her. And she said, "We do not want word to go out that we want to exterminate black people, the black population." And the minister is the man who can straighten out that idea if it ever occurs to any of their more rebellious members. I'm just like stunned when I was reading through this. And of course, you know, he has it all documented. He's got all these different things you can look at and you can see. You know, he's got the page numbers here so you can look at those. This woman had it out for black people. She was a white supremacist. She really was. She thought the white population was the best population, so it was what needed to control the others. It was the fit ones. And anybody who wasn't wealthy and good-looking and athletic and healthy, you were the fit ones. And if you weren't one of those, you didn't deserve to reproduce. I mean, this is what her idea was. If you've never studied her before, you really need to look into her, because she hated the whole idea of womanhood, I think. You know, being able to give life to a child, for her, she was like, no, the worst thing you can do is have a baby. I mean, that was the mentality that you see throughout. Now, in writing my book series, I've got several of my books written, but they're in draft form, and I'm revising them and working on them, making them actually sound decent. And one of them has to do with the whole eugenics movement. That was the spark that sent me off looking at, you know, how could this be used to take over the world? And it could be. I mean, it's very easy, because there are many different ways you can practice eugenics in our society right now, and some of them are legal, and we just don't know about it. So we're being manipulated. The propaganda, remember the propaganda one? Yeah. So this just, I mean, it goes through, and I read every bit of this, and it is well worth reading. But I'm not going to do it right now because it's getting late and I'm tired. I spent so much time reading this that I was like, oh man. Oh, I thought this was kind of interesting. In Iceland, the abortion rate for children diagnosed with Down syndrome in utero approaches 100%. So, in other words, in Iceland, they have no children who are born with Down syndrome. Why not? Because they abort them before they're born. That's why. Now, if you know anybody who has a child with Down syndrome, or if you know someone with Down syndrome, they're some of the most spectacular people in the world. They really are. And I just cannot even imagine, you know, not having some of those come out into our world. We need people like that, that are loving without judging, and just, you know, they're so sweet. It boggles my mind when I read about this stuff. So yeah, that's what Iceland is doing. And they're boasting, well, we don't have anyone with Down syndrome. Well, no, because you're killing them before they can be born. And there are actually some organizations in the United States that claim that they are helping reduce birth defects, and they're doing it by promoting abortions. They're developing tests that they can do before the child is born, genetic tests and things like that, so then they can, you know, abort the child before they're born. And that's how they plan on getting the birth defect rate down. I have a friend who's a writer who is a gynecologist, and we were discussing this one time, and he was telling me about that, because he said that's what they're doing. They claim that they're helping reduce birth defects. And there's one in particular, but I'm not going to say it because I don't want to get in trouble. I don't want to get somebody mad at me. But it's one that is pretty famous, and they talk all the time about helping to reduce birth defects. Yeah, they're doing it by promoting abortions for those children. So it's kind of sad. Anyway, if you continue on with these statistics, you can see other European countries have similarly high rate, and the rate in the United States is approximately 2/3. So like 98% in Denmark. This is how many are aborted, okay? The abortion rate for children diagnosed with Down syndrome, okay? 98% of those in Denmark, 90% in the UK, 77% in France. Do you really want socialized medicine? Because this is what happens. When you have socialized medicine, you don't get a choice. Your child is tested. You find out that that baby you're carrying is going to be born with Down syndrome. Guess what? Aborted. You have no choice. That's the way it works. And, you know, 67% in the United States is pretty high, too. It's crazy. And, of course, in Asia, widespread sex-selective abortions have led to as many as 160 million missing women, more than the entire female population of the United States. 160 million women. You want a war on women? That's a war on women. When you don't put a ban on being able to choose the sex of your child and abort the ones you don't want, you're killing women, because that's what's going to happen. Most of the babies that are aborted for sex reasons are female. Here in the United States, too. So, over the course of several decades, look at this one. 300,000 to 700,000 female fetuses were selectively aborted in India each year. Today, there are about 50 million more men than women in the country. I mean, he did such a good job with this. There is so much information in here. And, of course, you know that the reported nationwide abortion ratio, the number of abortions per 1,000 live births, okay, so your abortions per 1,000, among black women is nearly 3.5 times the ratio for white women. So, yeah, it's hitting the black population. And here it says, and there are areas in New York City in which black children are more likely to be aborted than they are to be born alive, and are up to 8 times more likely to be aborted than white children in the same area. I mean, it's just, there's actually a website called Black Genocide, blackgenocide.org. And this is put together by people that understand that abortion really is targeting the black population. And here they have a lot of things that you can go through. There's radio interviews. They talk about Planned Parenthood. They talk about crisis pregnancies. You know, if you are in a crisis pregnancy, there's help for you. There's resources. And that's what that Indiana law was supposed to do, to provide women with resources so they had options. But oh no, the abortion people don't want that, because they want women to remain ignorant about it. And, you know, that's sad. These people are all supposed to be for women's rights, and they turn around and they do that, and they say, oh, well, you know, we don't need to know that information. Yeah, they do. Women should have that information. If you're going to go in for any operation, they're going to tell you this stuff. You need to know it. So, anyway, 60% of the babies the Alabama abortion ban would save from abortions are black. Yeah, it is a type of black genocide, and that's what's happening. Well, anyway, he goes through, and like I said, this whole thing is well worth the read. I mean, really it is. And he says again that, you know, in March 2016, the Indiana legislature passed by wide margins the sex-selective and disability abortion ban at issue here. Respondent Planned Parenthood promptly filed a lawsuit to block the law from going into effect, arguing that the Constitution categorically protects a woman's right to abort her child based solely on the child's race, sex, or disability. The district court agreed, granting a preliminary injunction on the eve of the law's effective date, followed by a permanent injunction. And a panel of the Seventh Circuit affirmed. And so that's what he says. It's going to come down to this, and we are going to have to decide this eventually. You know, maybe not yet, maybe it's not time yet, but eventually the Supreme Court is going to have to decide. And I can tell you what, this man right here, he's going to vote to uphold that ban on those kinds of abortions based solely on race or sex or disability. He will uphold that ban. Anyway, this is Ginsburg's dissenting opinion. And, you know, she goes through on this. It is not very long. And she's just, I agree with the court's disposition of the second question presented, which meant, you know, I agree that we should not have dealt with that thing about the sex and the abortions based solely on sex and disability and all that. We shouldn't have dealt with that. As to the first question, I would not summarily reverse a judgment when application of the proper standard would likely yield restoration of the judgment. I mean, this is not very good, okay? It's not well written. It is very short, if you want to say that. This is all the longer it is. That's it. And I've read some of her dissenting opinions before, and this is not typical. This is not typical. So I think somebody else wrote it. You know, I think she probably is still alive, but who knows? I think they're keeping her as a figurehead. They're doing like a Weekend at Bernie's type thing, although she's still alive, barely. And they kind of keep her on ice when they're not using her, when she's not actually being there for anything. And who knows, maybe they've got it set up so that she can have a closed circuit TV type situation where she can watch what's going on and hear everything. And I don't know. But yeah, I don't think she's in good shape. We haven't seen or heard hardly anything from her. And the idea that this was put out, you know, Justice Ginsburg, kind of wonder if they did that just to make it appear that she's, you know, doing okay. It's like when Nadler had his little episode that kind of looked like a stroke or a heart attack or something, you know, he then tweeted. Yeah, somebody tweeted. I don't know that it was necessarily him, but, you know, somebody did. Anyway, so that's what I've got for you on this one. I'm going to put all these links down below. And since this video, I'm sure, is not going to be included in a lot of the YouTube recommended videos because of the subject content, I'm going to include a few more things. So this article right here by The Hill, I thought this was interesting because now there's a bunch of states that are taking up abortion laws. So annoying. I hate going to The Hill because it does this. Anyway, you have all these different states. I mean, there's lots of them. You have the Alabama one, the Arkansas, Georgia, Indiana. Well, you know, Indiana is trying to still get the other ones taken care of. But our governor, Eric Holcomb, signed two abortion-related measures in April, both of which limit access to the procedure. One law signed by Holcomb prohibits dilation and evacuation abortions, which is sucking the baby out, and it tears them limb from limb. It's awful. It's horrible. There are exceptions for women who would suffer substantial and irreversible physical damage from continuing the pregnancy. It takes effect on July 1st, but the ACLU said it plans to sue. Again, they're suing us all. And Kentucky, a judge has temporarily blocked a heartbeat bill from going into effect. And we have another heartbeat bill, Mississippi, Missouri, New York. Yeah, and the New York one, Cuomo signed a bill that protects access to abortion, even if Roe v. Wade is overturned. The law decriminalizes abortion and allows some late-term abortions in cases where the fetus is not viable or when necessary to protect the mother's life. You know, so anyway, it goes on and on. There's lots of them that are happening right now. Things are going to end up at the Supreme Court. I can tell you that. And I think we have a really good shot at overturning it. But I think we definitely need Ruth Bader Ginsburg's seat. Because I don't trust John Roberts right now. He's definitely a never-Trumper. But whether he's deep state or not, I think he's being blackmailed or, I don't know, he might be part of them. But he's definitely being controlled right now. And it's not by the good guys. So anyway, I've got that article for you. I also want to point this out to you because I thought this was kind of interesting. Eric Holder was linked to a doctor who killed a patient in an abortion in 2012, October 31st, 2012. This guy right here was an abortionist and he ended up killing a woman. And, you know, he also was committing fraud with Medicaid. $380,000 in payments for abortion ultrasounds Malloy never did, and abortions that did not qualify for reimbursement under Medicaid. Yeah, well, he was indicted, and also this Warner, which, wait until I find that somewhere. Where's the Warner? Kathy Ann Warner. That's supposed to be a mugshot, okay? And it's about the right time frame. Total bond was $50,000. Was 58 when the arrest took place. And it says gender male. So I don't know what's going on there. I don't know. But yeah, she was part of it. And, you know, this article was complaining about Eric Holder because they have been attempting to prosecute him. They have been attempting to prosecute pro-life people under the Freedom of Access to Clinic Entrances Act of 1994. And she's referring to Eric Holder when he was the Attorney General. And as far as I know, they have lost 100% of those cases in the last 4 years. And what the deal was, how Holder was connected, was that the office that this guy was working out of was in a building that was owned by his wife and his sister-in-law. And then they put it into a family trust. So then they said, oh, well, we don't own it. It's in the trust. Yeah, well, who owns the trust? I mean, really, when it comes down to it, I know technically nobody does, but yeah, there are trustees and their names are on there as the trustee. So he did not disclose that. And there was a big ethics thing that was going on. And, you know, this was all happening right before the 2012 election, but I never heard of it. Or maybe I heard of it and I forgot it, but I don't think so. And so he did end up getting sentenced to prison, the physician, and he was found guilty by a jury on both counts of the indictment. And that was in 2014. And it says down here, the judge will hold a restitution hearing at a later date to determine the exact amount of restitution he'll be ordered to pay. And $386,000 is what they were looking for. And I can't remember. It says somewhere what his sentence was. Where was it? Here it is. To 4 years in prison and 6 years probation on two counts of Medicaid fraud. So he did get caught. He did get indicted, contrary to what Eric Holder probably wanted to have happen. But yeah, there was a little bit of a conflict there. And so anyway, I wanted to point that out to you. And this one doesn't really have to do with the subject. But again, while I'm here, I might as well. This is Department of Justice. I came across all these things while I was looking for stuff. But check this out. Chief executive of a communications company sentenced to prison for providing encryption services and devices to criminal organizations. Yeah, this guy, and chief executive of Canada-based Phantom Secure, was sentenced to 9 years in prison today for leading a criminal enterprise that facilitated the transnational importation and distribution of narcotics through the sale of encrypted communication devices and services, and he was ordered to forfeit $80 million as proceeds of the crime, as well as specifically identified assets, including international bank accounts, real estate, cryptocurrency accounts, and gold coins. Yep, so he got nailed. And that was today. Well, when you see this, it'll be yesterday. So, there. This last one didn't have really anything to do with it, but I thought it was kind of interesting when I came across it. So that's what I've got for you on this one. I know it was long. I understand that, and I apologize, but wow, you know, this stuff, you really need to read that opinion by Justice Thomas. It's amazing. And if you didn't know anything about the eugenics movement in the United States, you need to read that and find out, because he lays it all out for you, and he tells you what their purpose was. And that's how this whole birth control abortion movement got started. And Planned Parenthood is right at the heart of it all. And by the way, if you look, there are lots of cases where Planned Parenthood actually was doing some dirty dealings and charging Medicaid more than it was supposed to. There's actually a lot of cases out there. I'm kind of surprised. But anyway, so yeah, it's all tied up with different things, and it's going to be coming out. It's all going to come to a head, because these laws, when you have them like this, they're pointing out the flaws with the abortion logic. And when it gets to the Supreme Court, we're going to have a majority, I hope. When Ruth Bader Ginsburg is out and we get somebody in there, I believe it's going to be a female this time. You know, they put a female in, what are they going to do? They can't do the sexual assault thing. So I don't know. And she is a woman, you know. The left always wants to promote women, and unless, of course, they're conservatives. But anyway, so that's what I've got for you on this. Again, I apologize for it being so long, but I just had so much to include. All the links will be down below, just like usual. And I want to thank you so much for stopping by, and I'll see y'all later.